Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Essential Lectures in Jewish History. I hope you like this beautiful new green screen I have behind me. I can do all kinds of cool things with it. I just got it this morning, and I hope I'll be able to put all kinds of excellent pictures behind me and use it in so many ways that you will be able to appreciate these videos even more. Okay, so over the next 15 minutes or so, I'd like to give you a very quick overview of American Jewish history. This is a complicated thing for me to talk about because it's so close to me. It's like right in front of my face. And as historians, we generally like to talk about things that happened a long time ago. The things that happened right now are much more difficult for us to figure out. So we usually give those things to the political scientists or sociologists. And the things that happen in the future, we give those generally to the Department of Prophecy, which is quite a ways down the hall from my office. But let's talk very quickly about American Jewish history. Okay, so there are three significant waves of Jewish immigration, and they are significantly larger as we move on throughout history. The first wave are the Sephardic Jews who come in the 17th century, starting really in the 1650s, and they're tiny little populations that establish beachheads in places like Charleston, South Carolina, or New York as well. These are populations that in many ways were fleeing the Spanish Inquisition as it reached out to the colonies. One of the first populations of Jews that arrived in New York, for example, were Jews from South America who had made it here, petitioned the authorities to live in this region, and received extensive rights, especially when New Amsterdam became New York. But these are tiny little settlements of Jews making very, very little impact on the overall population. A more significant population of Jews comes in the 1840s, primarily from Germany. And the Jews who are coming to America at that time are primarily fleeing economic difficulties, economic restrictions, sometimes a certain amount of anti-Semitic discrimination that comes, for example, from restrictive marriage laws that will only allow a certain number of Jews to marry per family and so on. So they come to America to try and, you know, the land of opportunity to explore new options for them. The third and largest group of immigrants comes after the 1880s, and these are Jews primarily from the former Russian Empire. In the early 1880s, there's a series of pogroms, that is, these kind of spontaneous attacks on Jewish populations that the Russian Empire proved incapable of halting over 4 years of sporadic violence. These pogroms, especially in the 1880s, were not huge and extremely violent attacks like we would see in the 20th century. Although they would escalate, they would get much worse in 1903, 1905, 1919, and then especially, of course, in the Holocaust. But nevertheless, the fact that the Russian Empire was not able to really stop them was something that was very significant for the Jews of Ukraine, Poland, and regions like that. And so combine that with the anti-Semitic policies of the Russian government and the lack of economic possibilities in the region meant that a lot of Jews sought out the Golden Medina, the Golden Land that was the New World. And so about 1.7 million Jews came from Eastern Europe to America between 1880 and 1924. At that time, the American government began to really shrink the immigration quotas, and very few Jews were allowed into the country. Tragically, this was also the case during the Holocaust, although many Jews chose to go to other countries, South America, a significant number to Israel in the early Zionist movement, Canada, a civilized country to the north, which has, for example, universal health care, things like that. So these are, that's the basic three major waves of Jewish immigration. And once again, they get progressively larger. There's a certain amount of internal conflict between the waves of Jews. The German Jews, for example, although very charitably inclined towards their compatriots from, or I should say their co-religionists from Eastern Europe, nevertheless regarded them with some disdain because they tended to be much lower on the socioeconomic ladder coming in as immigrants, and they had to work their way up from, let's say, being pushcart sellers of recycled goods until they finally were able to establish some kind of storefront, and then in some cases even establish large department stores. by and large, the story of American Jewry in America is, did I say that? By and large, the story of Jews in America is a very successful one in which Jews really take advantage of the tremendous opportunities of this land in order to grow their primarily economic situation, their educational situation, and so on. But at the same time, there is a huge decline in religious observance. We should bear in mind that, particularly for those Jews leaving Eastern Europe in the 1880s, these were Jews who were bucking the system. These were Jews who were going against the conventional wisdom, which was that America was not the golden Medina, the golden land, it was in fact the treifa Medina, the non-kosher land, primarily because of its dearth of major Jewish institutions such as schools, synagogues, mikvahs, Chinese restaurants, you name it. There was very little here for Jews coming from Eastern Europe. And so as a result, those Jews who tended to immigrate before the Holocaust tended to come with a kind of willingness to adapt to America, a special desire to learn English, and even to refrain from teaching their children Yiddish, the overwhelmingly dominant vernacular of Eastern Europe. And they were willing to become Americans and do everything it took to become Americans. This was not the case for the Jews who came after the Holocaust, who were not immigrants, they were refugees. Whereas the immigrant mentality is, I'm open to this country, I'm going to make myself over like this country, this is totally new and different and I embrace it. A refugee comes with a mindset, my home was destroyed, my culture was destroyed, I will not open myself up to this foreign environment, I am going to make this foreign environment like my old home environment in Eastern Europe. And so there's a huge marked distinction between those two groups. Let's jump ahead a little bit, because there's a lot to cover, and I really want to focus on the turn of the 21st century. One of the major stories of American Jewry, besides the tremendous growth economically and educationally, in terms of their advancement in all fields of human endeavor, really, is the decline in the character of their Jewish observance and their Jewish identity in many ways. It is a story of increasing assimilation. We should understand that term. Assimilation, you know, if you borrow it from the chemical sciences, essentially refers to like dissolving a solid within a liquid, and so that the solid is no longer visible. That's kind of a harsh term to use when you talk about Jews in America, because in many ways they tend to remain doggedly insistent on certain Jewish markers of identity. For example, most surveys indicate that Jews, no matter how tenuous their connection to Judaism is, they nevertheless retain a high degree of pride in their Jewish identity, and they will strongly identify themselves as a Jew, even if the other behaviors that they may manifest will not necessarily be in harmony with that view. On the other hand, every other marker shows Jews kind of walking away from Judaism. In the 2013, the Pew Research study appeared, which was an especially damning report on the state of Jewish identity in America, and it indicated that Jewish intermarriage was well over 50%. And this is a phenomenon that had been observed for several decades. It's at the state where roughly 6 out of every 10 Jews who gets married to a non-Jew. That's a huge figure. Now, obviously, there are differences between the denominations. And in fact, in many ways, America is the place where many of the denominations really flourished. We spoke about denominations in an earlier lecture. But here in America, the conservative movement and the reform movement, for example, grew apace throughout the 20th century. But their intermarriage rates grew at a commensurate rate with the growth of the denomination. This is a very serious phenomenon, especially when you join that to the fact that roughly one quarter of all children born of intermarriages, and this is referring to whether the mother or the father is Jewish, Jewish law traditionally ascribes Jewish identity only to those children born of a Jewish mother, or those who convert to Judaism. Only one-fourth of children born of a marriage between a Jew and a non-Jew identify themselves as Jews. So you combine intermarriage with a low level of identification of children of intermarriage, and you see the Jewish community is in many ways essentially marrying itself out of existence in America. There are other factors involved. For example, Jewish women tend to be highly educated. They're one of the most highly educated of all ethnic groups in America. High education is often correlated with low levels of fertility, meaning Jewish women are much less likely to have children because they postpone childbirth till their education and their careers are well underway. So the Jewish birth rate is about 1.1 overall, well below replacement value. And again, there's denominational shifts in that. The Orthodox birth rate is quite a bit higher. It's about 4 and a bit per family, but nevertheless, still a very serious phenomenon for the long-range demographic of the Jews, because Orthodox Jews constitute only about 10% of the American Jewish population. Now, I'd like to spend the last couple minutes of this video talking about Samuel Heilman's thesis. That's an extremely important one for us to understand if we're going to look at the future of the Jews of America. I know I said prophecy was down the hall, but this is a phenomenon that we have observed for the last half century, and so therefore it's worth discussing in this context. Here's basically what Dr. Heilman argues is happening to American Jewry. If you were to look at, let's say we make a chart, and let's say on the vertical axis we put the number of Jews. Okay, so higher up on the y-axis you have more Jews, lower down you have less Jews. And then on the x-axis, let us place levels of Jewish identification, which means obviously Jews who are observant tend to be very high on that scale, but add other groups like, let's say, quite determined Jewish Zionists or Jewish socialists, people who are really well invested and have lots of daily markers in their lifestyle of Jewish identity, they would score high on that score. So if you looked at American Jewry in 1950, you'd have a significant number of Jews who were towards the non-identified or non-affiliated area of that chart. And then you have a very small amount who are highly affiliated, and you have a big camel hump in the middle of Jews who are moderately affiliated. Those moderately affiliated Jews were extremely important for the maintenance of Jewish life to the right of them, meaning those Jews who are highly affiliated. And I'll explain why. Because if you look at the Jews at the turn of the 21st century, for example, you'll see that there's an even larger group of Jews who are non-affiliated and remarkably low levels of Jewish identification. You have a higher incidence, small but still higher incidence of Jews who are highly affiliated. This might refer to the burgeoning so-called Baal Tshuva movement, those Jews who become observant later in life, which really took off after the Six-Day War in the late 1960s. And so there's a significant number of Jews who are sort of returning to Judaism in very significant numbers. But the moderately affiliated Jew, that camel hump that was present in the very first slide, the very first period that we were talking about, they've disappeared, and they're basically nowhere. So that, you know, is a very scary thing for a demographic perspective, but it's even more serious because if you think about the money that those people used to invest in Jewish life. In the 1950s, people who might not necessarily, for example, send their children to Jewish schools would nevertheless give a donation to a local Jewish school because they believed in the idea of Jewish education. Or they might not necessarily visit Israel, but you know what? They would give to United Jewish Appeal. They would give their money, as it were, to the right. In the 21st century, however, even though Jews are, in general, much more wealthy, the third, fourth generation are much more wealthy than their precursors, their money is typically going to other philanthropic causes. Very valuable ones, but not Jewish. For example, the art gallery or the local hospital. Lots of causes which are really important for the general society, but they are impoverishing the Jewish institutions that support those on the right. So Dr. Heilman argues that if this trend continues, it will be impossible financially for Orthodox Jews to maintain their lifestyle in this country, and they will in fact have to immigrate to Israel. That's a very dire kind of prediction. At any rate, that's a very quick overview of American Jewish history from its beginnings in the 17th century with emphasis on the early 21st century. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you love this new green screen. I'm going to have so much fun with it. Okay, I'll talk to you in the next lecture.
Stand clear of the closing doors, please.